Good day, students. Welcome to our first part of information systems for computer practice N6. My name is Mr. Dlamini, and I'm a lecturer for this module. This module consists of three sections. These sections, the first one being theory, second one Word, Microsoft Word, Microsoft Excel, the third one. Under our theory, we've got four subsections. The first one being information systems, the second one operating systems, which is also called system software. Then the third one, computer viruses. The fourth is troubleshooting. So for this lesson, our focus is on information systems. We will do just part one of information systems. Then we will look at the definition for information systems. Information systems is an integrated system that collects, creates, calculates, manipulates, and provides information to support management. So if we look at this definition, integrated, the term there, integrated, which means for the fact that we are calling this a system, it means there are many elements that are working together to form a system. So the integrated, the term integrated, it refers to these elements that are integrated, that are combined to work together, to collect information. That refers to information that is being inputted into a system. That is created from scratch, new information, this one. And then it will calculate, like our Caltech system will calculate your results, like your ICAS result. It will calculate for you. It can then manipulate the results, whether you qualify or not qualify for your exam. And such information will be given, it's offered to the management. It helps to support information, that information. So the management will use that information to make decisions. So an information system is very important for every institution or company, as it keeps information. So information is power. That is why it's important to keep this information correct all the time. So regardless of the different kinds of information systems that we have, there are common elements that, whether you like it or not, every information system will have it, regardless of its nature. There are five elements that we'll look at, basic elements. The first one is people. As you can see, the term people is in plural. It refers to people, a person, humans, that one. It is the most important element in the information system. As it is in plural, it refers to many roles that people play in a system. Those who create, developers who created the system, who developed the system from scratch. We've got engineers, software engineers that masters the software part of it. And we've got testers. Once the system is developed, there will be people that specialize in testing if it offers the intended purpose or results. And then you'll have people that are using it, data capturers. You'll have people that we call technicians to maintain the system. So that role, like it or not, every system will have those roles. And the next one, it's machines. The machines we are referring to, hardware day. It can be printer, it can be your screen. Every system will have hardware. It will have machines there that are required for the system to function properly. So that we cannot run away from. Then the next one is procedures. When you look at procedures, those are guidelines or instructions on how to use a system. Every system will come with a manual, will come with instruction that needs to be followed whenever you are doing something. When you are collecting information, there is a procedure. When you are creating information, there is a procedure that needs to be followed. Like when you are buying your new cell phone, it will come with a small booklet to tell you how to make a call, how to send a message, and so on. So those are procedures. Then the fourth one is database. Database is your storage where you need to keep your information. Every system uses a database to store its information. Then the fifth one is control. Control, that's where now you are evaluating all the elements from the first one till the fourth one. People, machines, procedures, database. You are checking if they are performing up to the standard, up to the required standard. You check people. If they are underperforming, you conduct control to check people. If they are underperforming, you will train them. Or if you are not training them, maybe you will put them somewhere else where they are good. Change them from their current duties. And then machines. Maybe you will be checking a printer. If a printer is coping or not, if the printer is not good enough for the system, you will upgrade to a better print. Procedures. If procedures are too difficult for the users to follow, then you simplify. You will review your procedures and the system as well. Database. You check the performance of the database. If it is not good enough for the system, you will change it to a more suitable database. That is a purpose of a control, the element control. That is why you will have a system version 1. When you perform a controls and then you correct, you make corrections to the system, you produce version 2. As you improve because of control. Then we proceed. We look at the three terms: data, information, and knowledge. They look the same, but they are different in nature. Then we will differentiate these three. The first one, data. Data, basic element of information, part of information, in fact. Then contents, facts, or description of objects and events. That is also data. Unprocessed information. In fact, all these three lines, if you look careful, what is important is that with data, there is no meaning. Because this small part of information, it has no meaning. For example, if you say 34 computers. If you just look at the number, data will be just 34. So 34 on its own does not make any sense. Then if you say now 34 computers, if you add meaning to it, 34 computers, then it becomes information. In short, when you get information, when you add meaning to it, data, that is how you process the data to get information. The moment you add information, you add meaning, you add usefulness to your data, then it becomes information. So the information is used for decision making. it's there to support decision makers in the decision making process so that they make good decisions based on good information. That is why it's important for information to be good and correct all the time, because wrong information will yield to wrong decisions. And we look at knowledge. Knowledge basically is what you know. Not all the information that is available out there is known to you. But the information, when you grasp the information, it becomes knowledge to you, it becomes known to you, then it changes its format to knowledge. Then, how does then information becomes knowledge? It needs to be interpreted. It needs to be simplified. That is why we've got lessons, to simplify, to interpret information so that it becomes knowledge to the student. So this knowledge is a basis of information for a specific purpose. So this knowledge is arranged in such a way that it suits a specific purpose. As you can see here, this entire knowledge, this information here, is specific for information systems under computer practice. Then we proceed. Fields, records, and files. We need to differentiate to describe these terms, these three terms. Field, what is a field? A field refers to a set of characters. Set of characters. Set of characters can be your name, your surname, your gender. Those are set of characters. It's made up of characters, a number of characters, a field. Then when you combine fields, a set of fields, it gives us a record. A record. A record, and a good example that you can relate to, a good example of a record is your CV. In your CV, you've got name, cause, experience, qualification, criminal record. So whosoever is looking for someone, through your CV, they can understand without knowing you, but by looking at your CV, your record, they will know what kind of a person you are. A criminal or not, an expert in the field or not, just by looking. So it's a set of fields, the record. Then the file. The file is the storage of records. You keep records in a file, like a CV will be kept in a Word document where you type all your records. So it keeps, a file keeps records. It's a collection of records. Then we proceed. We look at different types of files. We've got three different types of files. The first one being the master file. The master file refers to permanent files that changes after a long time. Good example of a master file is syllabus. You don't just change a syllabus overnight. You need to have concrete reason, concrete motive to change the syllabus. Then the second one is transaction file. This one refers to temporal files that change regularly. An example of that one would be your bank account. It changes regularly. You can deposit cash 3 times a day. You can deposit cash 10 times if you like. Withdraw 20 times is up to you. It will change any time. So those transaction files are temporal. They change regularly, any time. Then table file, it's fairly permanent. Files used for referencing purposes. These files, they are fairly permanent. A good example is that one of a table, text table used for finance purposes. To calculate tax, it changes regularly, annually, every year. The financial year starts 1st of March to the following year, end of February, the following year. So, to calculate what is called pay as you earn, it comes there with figures that changes every year on how to calculate tax. You refer, as we are saying, is used for referencing purpose. You refer using that table. Like another example, the equations. You've got an equation sheet, a file that you use in school. You used in school. Whenever you want to calculate something like under physics, you want to calculate voltage, you will find an equation for calculating voltage there. So it's used for referencing. Then we proceed. Then we look at the processing methods or modes. Within the information system, everything that you do, you create information, you collect information, you make calculations and so on. All of that, those are processing methods. There will be a way of doing it. So everything you do in a system is called a transaction. Whether you add information, you delete information, that is a transaction. You change information, that is a transaction. You log into the system, that is a transaction. So the processing mode of whatsoever transaction that you are performing with in a system, then let's look at three different modes of methods, how transaction get processed in your system. The first one is batch processing. Batch processing, batch refers to a group, which means the transactions are processed in groups. Maybe if your system processes transaction 5 at a time, which means it needs to wait for 5 transactions, then it will be processed. If there are 2, it will wait until it reaches 5, then it gets processed, depending on the rules and the settings on the system. Then we look at online entry method. This one, what is special about this one is that it is online, which meaning that you can perform transaction wherever you are. The location is not a problem. As you are accessing this system, this lesson, you are accessing it online from home. So the location is not a problem. You can access, you can process the transaction on wherever you are, any location. Location is not a problem, which meaning it is centralized, it's accessible from anywhere. Then the third one is real-time processing method. This one, the transactions are processed immediately. There is no waiting period. There are no delays when it comes to this one. A good example of this one is cash withdrawal. Whenever you withdraw cash, a new balance will be reflected immediately, because you cannot withdraw many times without a balancing adjusting accordingly, because you will end up, the bank might end up losing if they don't keep track of your balance immediately. So real-time processing method, the transactions in that mode, they are processed immediately, quickly. Then the last section that we look at under our information system, part one, this is the last section, is a audit trail. With the audit trail, what is happening? You are tracing, tracking whosoever that is responsible for that one. Normally it will be from the management for tracking, what, tracing a transaction from the beginning till the end. Usually that process is conducted to track what each user has been doing on the system. Sometimes what could trigger that process as well, if there is fraud that has been conducted on the system, the audit trail will have to take place. If anything, in fact, the system, every information system keeps records of what is happening. So that helps to track everything. So it's important that as a user, you do what is appropriate on the system. You behave. Don't think anything is in secret here. There is no secret on the system. Everything is just visible. There is no secret. Can be traced. So please behave. Respect your work. Thank you. So that this is the end of the lesson for part one of information system.